I warmly welcome our first speaker. Her name is Suzan Fiack. She is head of the Press and Public Relations Unit in the Risk Communication Department at the BFR. So yes, we work very closely together. Suzan Fiack is responsible for communicating risks and scientific content to the public in a way that is appropriate to the target group. Previously, she worked in scientific publishing and as a scientist at university and industry. A warm welcome to Suzan Fiack.
Thank you. Thank you, Sonja. Dear ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, thank you for coming here and celebrating with us our anniversary, 20 years of scientific assessment, research, and communication. And as already mentioned, and you've probably realized, everything is science here. We are a lot of scientists, and we are a scientific institution through and through. Science first, we just heard, and even the press department is based on science. So we really want to understand the assessments, the science behind the assessments. We need to understand also the context. We define our messages, we find out our target audiences, we explain, we even visualize, and we circulate our messages. Finally, we evaluate our work. And a lot of people ask me now, Suzan, why do we need all this now? This visualization, social media, why is it important? And I would just like to highlight two aspects. One of them is we really need to be there where the people are. This is, I mean, luckily we have in our department also social scientists, so we look very deep into perception. This is about formats. Of course, there are a lot of statistics around. This is a perception of coronavirus, but I would like to draw your attention to the fact that most of the people, the older age groups, for them, the primary sources for news is still television, radio, and also print. But if you look at the younger age group, this is not longer the case. So social media is getting more and more important, and the classical formats decline. The second aspect is risk perception. We have a consumer monitor, so a biannual survey. It's representative, and we ask, for example, this is just one example of all the questions we ask. We ask, in your opinion, what are the biggest health risks for consumers? And the answer is, because the most respondents named undesirable substances in general. And if you look in the raw data, people say pollutants, toxic substances, and chemistry. They even do not say there are chemicals in my food or product. They say chemistry. Probably a lot of you would say if there's no chemistry in the food, you would probably not have any food at all. But if it comes to such attitudes or fears or values, probably it's not enough to just deliver scientific information. So what we aim to do is we want to reach new target audiences. We can visualize also emotions, very strange for scientists, but important if it comes to risk perception. We can explain even better. And I think it's also an attitude that we can say we are scientists, but we really want to be understood. And we also know from research projects, for example, that the Harding Center for Risk Literacy, that a combination of verbal and graphic risk communication can reduce false estimations and also promote risk-literate decisions. And now I come to the example. So what we did several years ago, we had a really nice annual report with a lot of good content, but now we publish a biannual magazine, which is well-designed, it has infographics, interviews, it's an e-paper also, and also an app. And we also have infographics. On the left side, you see what we did before. A lot of text, sometimes a little visual, like a carrot. But now we really try to explain, for example, in this case, the perception of eating insects. In fact, people do not really like to eat insects. acceptance might increase if they are in form of a burger, just by the way. What we also changed is our brochure. We have a brochure, Poisoning Accidents Among Children, and we put all the content into an app, and we also included the possibility to call the poisoning information centers. And so this is a totally change, and we have much more downloads, of course, than before with the print brochure. And we also won the German Prize for Online Communication on this once. And I think this is very important. We have developed an infographic, the difference between hazard and risk. This is very important in communication, especially if it comes to the sentence, there's chemistry in my food. Because often the simple sentence of Paracelsus, the dose makes the poison, is not understood. And of course, if a hazard is really associated with a risk, depends on exposure. So we said how much, how long, how often. And we tried to explain this with the beer. As long as it is in the zoo, we do not expect any health damage. And the same applies to prussic acid, for example. It's hydrogen cyanide, and it occurs naturally in apricot kernels, for example, or in flax seeds. But also here, the dose makes the poison. If you do not eat like 15 grams flax seed at a time, or not more than 2 apricot kernels per day, we do not expect any health damage. And this also applies to pesticide residues. I mean, as long as the pesticide is used as intended, and we have all this regulation, and for example, also the active substance is assessed on a European level, we also do not expect any health damage. So the next example, our president already mentioned fipronil, and fipronil was a case, I think, all over in Europe and also in Asia. We had higher levels of fipronil in eggs. Fipronil is an insecticide. It is used to combat insects, but it was illegally used by a cleaning company to combat the red bird mite, and we had higher level. And if you, I think it always happens at the weekend. We came to the BFR and our scientists said, this is the assessment, and we came into discussion. And as you see, we calculated with the worst case. We said the acute reference dose for children is exceeded by chicken eggs. And then we said, this does not necessarily mean that the consumption of chicken eggs poses a health risk, but a health risk is possible for children with the required margin of safety after consuming these contaminated chicken eggs. And then we said, what does this now mean for consumers? And I think this is the task we have, to really understand the scientific content and then try to develop messages. And luckily, we are really in good contact with our scientists because it does only work with a good internal communication. And we finally said and visualized it with all the signs around that adults can eat 7 eggs and a child can eat 1 egg. And media really liked it. Even the Guardian spoke about the 7 eggs of the German Federal Institute for Risk Assessment. And the title of my presentation is How to Develop New Tailored Communication Tools. And of course, it's a process. We really need to understand the science, and we need a good cooperation in-house. This is just an example. It's about the number of animal experience per research purpose. And you start with something, and then you develop it over time. So it takes time. These are just some facts and figures. What we do at BFR, we are on Twitter, we are on Instagram. We now developed also LinkedIn because we realized that we have a lot of followers anyway, and now we have put more content into this. And quite new, since August, we are already on Mastodon. I don't know whether you've heard about it. It's a recommendation by the German Data Protection Officer, so we are also on different channels now. These are just an example. From our BFR Nectar Hector, which is a didactic plant labyrinth, which was developed by our BFR Academy, who, by the way, organizes this whole event here, so thank you to them as well. And we promoted this on social media. And we also have a video about how we did it. So we are getting more visuals into our communication. Also, for example, with cartoon characters. These are examples about correct cooling, and we have now at our department a unit visual communications, which is really helpful. And this is just an example which they developed also together with Claudia, who was already here, I think. Yeah, hi. We will also present later. And we have videos not only on Instagram, we put them on all our channels. And this is, by the way, about the flavors of e-cigarettes and how we assess them.
Am BSR stellen wir hier unsere eigenen E-Liquids her, um die gesundheitlichen Auswirkungen spezieller Aromastoffe zu untersuchen. Die rote Flüssigkeit ist das Zellkulturmedium, welches zusammen mit der E-Zigarette an eine Abrauchmaschine gekoppelt wird. Und beim Abrauchen der E-Zigarette werden die Substanzen, die beim Abrauchen entstehen, und die Aromastoffe aus dem E-Liquid im Zellkulturmedium gefangen. Dieses geben wir dann auf Lungenzellen, um hier die Wirkung der Aromastoffe zu untersuchen.
So these are my examples. We have more and we will develop more. Just some tips for you if you travel home at the end of my presentation. Thank you very much, and thank you to all of our unit, our members, and all the people who came here. And of course, if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them.